American colonies in the middle decades of the 18th century had to deal with their mother country, England. Leaders arose among the colonists who worked to awaken their countrymen. Pamphlets proclaiming the cause of the colonies flooded the country. One of the ablest of these pamphlets was penned by a young member of the Virginia House of Burgesses. He was Thomas Jefferson, and his pamphlet was called A Summary View of the Rights of British America.
Thomas, Mr. James is here.
Thank you, my dear. Mr. James, it's good to see you.
Mr. Jefferson, I came to tell you that Peyton Randolph will not be able to attend the Continental Congress. Therefore, you as deputy are requested to attend in his place.
I'll go, gladly.
Thank you, Mr. Jefferson.
Martha, I'm homesick already, and I haven't even left yet.
You won't be gone long.
Even a moment away from home is too long. Don't worry.
Good luck, Thomas.
I hope so. This is the colony's first great chance to prove that we can be united, to make all our own decisions, to govern ourselves.
Take care of yourself.
I will. Bye.
In July 1775, Jefferson, the third youngest member of the Continental Congress, wrote a final draft of the reply to Lord North, which rejected the terms offered by the ministry. Outraged by this, King George and his Tory Parliament declared the colonies in a state of rebellion. The Americans aggressively fought back. After a year of civil war, Thomas Jefferson and other radicals were back in the Continental Congress in Philadelphia, pressing for a clear-cut declaration of American independence. And on June 11, 1776, Congress appointed a committee to prepare that declaration.
The following members of Congress, in order of choice by ballot, have been selected to draw up the Declaration of Independence. John Adams, Benjamin Franklin, Roger Sherman, Robert R. Livingston, and Thomas Jefferson.
I propose that our young gentleman from Virginia, Mr. Jefferson, draw up the first draft of our declaration.
I am extremely honored, but I feel that you, Dr. Franklin, or Mr. Adams will...
Well, now, in my opinion, you're the man, Jefferson.
Of course. Your summary has shown us you can do it.
Thank you, gentlemen. I will proceed immediately.
Jefferson, working by himself, drew up the Declaration of Independence. And late in June, he went first to Mr. Adams, and then to Dr. Franklin for corrections. They made a few very trivial ones. It was then reported to the committee. And on July 2nd, it was brought before Congress, where it was debated 3 days before it was adopted.
When, in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitle them, a decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
Have they voted yet?
No, but it should be soon.
The sooner the better.
And for the support of this declaration, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor.
They're voting!
They're voting!
North Carolina, aye. New Hampshire,
aye.
Virginia,
aye.
Yes, on July 4th, 1776, the Declaration of Independence was adopted, and Thomas Jefferson had become a leader in the struggle for freedom. Jefferson returned to his beloved Monticello, where as a member of the Virginia legislature, he continued his battle for man's inalienable rights. In 1779, although Jefferson was only 36, he succeeded Patrick Henry as the second governor of Virginia. As governor of an invaded and war-exhausted state, he struggled against tremendous odds.
No, Martha, I'm not hungry.
Please, Thomas, you've been working too hard. You have to eat something.
Criticisms. Nothing but criticisms of me. I've tried my best, but we have no money, no supplies, and the Tories among us make us divided.
Darling, they have no right to rail at you so. We've had our losses, too. They've ruined some of our farms.
Oh, I'm tired. Would that I only could enjoy my home, my wife and family.
Since they do not appreciate you, you could resign. Let them find another governor.
No. I've got to stay on. They want a dictator. A man with unlimited power. I can't let them. That would be treason against the principles of a republic.
Yes, I know. But eat something. You'll feel better.
Governor Jefferson.
Yes? What is it?
Colonel Tarleton's troops. They're on their way here.
Colonel Tarleton? I had no idea.
What will we do?
We'll take to the woods. Hurry. Tell everyone.
Jefferson and his family evaded the redcoats, and he was re-elected governor. As his second term expired, a great tragedy befell him. His wife, Martha, died. Martha and Mary, the only survivors of his six children, were his constant companions and a great source of comfort to him. Although he vowed never again to enter politics, he was soon prevailed upon to serve in the Continental Congress. He made several important national contributions, among which was the Northwest Ordinance, that new states should be added to the original 13 on the basis of absolute equality. He tried to exclude slavery forever from the colonies, but was defeated by only one vote. In 1784, Jefferson went to France to assist Benjamin Franklin and John Adams in negotiating treaties of commerce. He stayed, however, as Franklin's successor for 5 years and did much to further friendly relationship between Europe and America. Jefferson returned from France and, upon the insistence of President Washington, became Secretary of State. This was the beginning of his long conflict with Alexander Hamilton. And finally, in 1793, Jefferson returned to Monticello.
Right over there, Sam. We won't plant tobacco in that tract next season.
Why not? We got tobacco in there now and it's doing fine.
A new idea. Rotation of crops. I think they'll do better that way.
Well, if you say so.
And that isn't all. I have a new plan for plowing also. Horizontally. Following the curvatures of the hills and hollows. The contours of the land.
Rotation of crops. Contour plowing. Well, I'll never. We used to just stick the seed in the ground and let it grow.